Well, a while ago, I published an article explaining how AI scrapers were placing a very heavy burden on open source projects. Though that is still true, some tools have been developed to address that, such as Anubis. Even earlier, we talked about whether open source projects should even allow AI code contributions or AI-generated bug reports. Many projects, such as Servo, decided not to allow them at all. However, things are moving and these discussions are taking place increasingly more often. Thus, I'd like to briefly address the question, how are Linux and the free and open source ecosystem dealing with AI? So let's start with this article by ZDNet. They claim that AI is creeping into the Linux kernel and official policy is needed as soon as possible. An example that they give is AutoCell, which is a modern AI-powered Linux kernel stable backboard classifier. According to the announcement, AutoCell automatically analyzes Linux kernel commits to determine whether they should be backported to stable kernel trees. It examines commit messages, code changes, and historical backporting patterns to make intelligent recommendations. This has been praised as a positive example of modern LLM usage, as it's meant to support a developer without replacing one, and it does not perform any action as it only presents advice without reasoning for it, and it's up to the developer whether to take it up or not. However, AI usage in the kernel goes way beyond the use of such tools. During the 2025 Open Source Summit, NVIDIA developer Sasha Levin shared that a patch that was credited to him was entirely AI generated, though it did review and test it. Note that this was not disclosed when the patch was submitted for review, at least to my knowledge. And please note also that AI agents are used here, meaning that LLMs are allowed to run Git commands to learn about the repositories, though I'm assuming that for the tool, the access is only read-only. Another example is the git resolve script that will resolve an ambiguous ID into a full commit. This was also completely generated and it included a set of test cases which is unusual for kernel scripts. AI code in the kernel includes some particularly sensitive work. In early 2024, the kernel took on the responsibility of assigning common vulnerabilities and exposure numbers, CVAs, and this began as a quick collection of bash scripts, but it quickly grew unmaintainable, so the team decided to use an LLM to translate those scripts to Rust, making CVE assignments code to be entirely AI generated. This raised, many questions, even just during the Levin's presentation. Isn't there a risk of trusting LLM's output too much? What's the licensing of AI generated content? Levin believes that if an LLM produces code, he is free to make any use of it, and this is somewhat debatable, as some complex legal issues depend on the country you live in, but this could be the topic of an entire other article. Let me know if you would like to see that. He's not the only one experimenting with this. Another example are dispatches by Cass Cook, who was experimenting to see how much code he could reasonably generate. Turns out he had success with some reasonable unit tests, which he claims saved him some time, though some prompting was required to nail it. However, it did not manage to save any time on non-test keys patches. And before I go on, this is day 2 of the advent of Nico, where I publish one video every day before Christmas with the goal of reaching 400 paid subscribers. I can't speak. The context is that I decided to quit my job to do videos, and this means that I now need a magic thing called revenue to pay for rent and such. Luckily, I already have 97 subscribers among Patreon, Libra, Pay, Ko-fi, and my website, thelibra.news, where you can read, by the way, this video as an article. And To those people, thank you so much. You're the only reason this video exists, because I don't do sponsors right now. So please help us break even, and continue doing these videos if you can. Anyhow, back to the video. Shortly after his talk, Levin sent a request for comments on a set of patches to introduce AI coding assistant configuration files to the Linux kernel documentation. Specifically, this consisted of two different patches. The first patch adds unified configuration files for various AI coding assistants: Cloud, GitHub, Copilot, Cursor, Codium, Continue, Windsurf, and Eider. These are all symlinked to a central documentation file to ensure consistency across tools. And the second patch adds the actual rules and documentation that guide AI assistants on Linux kernel development practices, including following kernel coding standards, respecting the development process, properly attributing AI generated contributions, and understanding licensee requirements. Interestingly enough, about this last thing, the AI is instructed to add itself as a co-author of all patches, but to only let a human sign off the commit, as that represents a legal certification. Along with this documentation for AI agents, there is a patch being reviewed to introduce guidelines for humans developers using AI. Please note that these guidelines only apply when a significant portion of the patch content is generated. Smaller tweaks, such as spelling and grammar fixes, variable renamings, and reformattings, are all out of scope. The guidelines ask them to disclose which tools were used, the input of these tools, such as the prompts that you chose, and which content exactly was AI generated. It's then up to the maintainers to choose what to do with that information. They might want to reject the patch outright, review it more carefully, suggest a better prompt, or just ask for more details. Or even accept it. Though I'm a bit worried that this is going to create very different practices and policies within the same kernel. Of course, the great Linus Torvalds has commented on this proposal as well. Here's what he had to say. And I quote, "Honestly, I think the documented rule should not aim to treat AI as anything special at all and literally just talk about tooling. In other words, this should all be about tool-assisted patches, should be described as such, and should explain how the tool was used. People should mention the tool it was done with, and the script," okay, the scripts are called prompts because AI is so special, "that was used. I would like to quickly mention that the Linux Foundation also has its own rules for the usage of generative AI tools. As a quick reminder, the work of the Linux Foundation goes well beyond Linux kernel development, as it also sponsors and works on hundreds of open source projects. The Linux Foundation only puts two rules on the AI generated content. Firstly, contributors should ensure that the terms and conditions of generative AI tools do not place any contractual restriction on how the tool's output can be used that are inconsistent with the project's open source software license, the project's intellectual property policies, or the open source definition. This seemed to be in line with the question that we asked earlier. What's the exact license of the content generated by AI? Since, again, the answer is not easy to obtain, the Linux Foundation seems to have this policy to, well, blame the developer if anything goes wrong. The second term is the following. Let me try to read this. If any pre-existing copyrighted materials, including pre-existing open source code, authored or owned by third parties, are included in the AI tool's output prior to the contributing such output to the project, the contributor should confirm that they have permission from the third party owners, such as the form of an open source license or a public domain declaration that complies with the project's licensing policies, to use and modify such pre-existing materials and contribute them to the project." I did that. Okay, this rule exists because LLMs models have been found to generate exact excerpts of their training data in small number of cases. This means that a developer should always check that the generated code does not contain any copyrighted materials, though it's unclear how they would do that. Well, these were the Linux kernel and Linux foundations, which both are very big institutions within the free and open source world, and they are worked on by companies such as NVIDIA itself. So I'm not surprised to see active work here on how to use these AI tools. But of course, the rest of the free and open source world is often a bit more hostile to these tools. Well, I already mentioned how Servo, the web engine currently developed by the Linux Foundation, entirely bans AI contributions, and this is due to claims of maintainer burden, or, well, lack of correctness of these patches, and the above-mentioned copyright issues. Multiple GNOME projects have also such a guideline, though I'm not currently aware of a project-wide stance on this. Elementary OS does have one, which is directly inspired by the one from GNOME, and same goes for FreeBSD and Gentoo. I can also share that... Can I? I'll do that. There has been some internal discussion within KDE on what a policy on AI contributions should look like. This was started by one patch that was submitted by developer Mikhail Sidorenko, which was generated by Cursor. Other projects have more moderate policies, which is more akin to the kernel one. One such example is Fedora, which does allow for AI assistance, but requires developers to follow some principles. Namely, you have to, one, take responsibility for your contribution regardless of how you made the patch. Two, you must disclose the usage of AI tools. The recommended method is to use the assisted by commit message trailer. And three, you must use AI as a tool to assist you. It should not be the sole or final arbiter in making judgment on a contribution. All of this brings me to Mozilla, which has recently been under fire for reportedly pivoting to AI, so I'll make examples later. They have guidelines that seem to be even more permissive of AI usage than the Linux kernels, as they only place one real constraint on these contributions. You are accountable for all changes you submit, regardless of the tools that you use. Now, a few weeks ago, Firefox published a blog post titled Introducing AI, the Firefox Way. I'm angry, I don't know if you heard that. The Firefox Way, a look at what we're working on and how you can help shape it. Well, according to them, they are making sure to protect your privacy by only running local models on your device, which means that no data leaves your machine. More on this soon. They integrate generative AI in many different places. There's automatic alt-text generation for images, which helps out with accessibility, and automatic translation of web pages. On iOS, you can even shake your device to summarize the page that you're currently viewing. This feature is also supported on the desktop, obviously. They're also experimenting with AI suggestions for tab groups. If you have a lot of tabs a similar topic and try to create a tab group, Firefox will automatically suggest a name to use. There's also link preview, which will show you a snippet from a link that you're hovering over. And you're also given the option to have a sidebar with a direct link to a chatbot, which could be any from Claude to Gemini, even Mistral. For obvious reasons, however, this feature cannot run locally and requires you to accept the privacy policy of the selected chatbot. Effectively, it's a bit like having a pinned web page with the chatbot. Finally, they want to take on this. They want to take this a step further and create AI windows where the AI assistant that you select will be able to interact with the page that you're seeing. That this feature isn't publicly available yet. It's interesting to see Mozilla try to strike a balance between being modern and appealing to tech bros, I guess, but also not alienate their existing user base. On one hand, I appreciate that most, if not everything that they're doing is opt-in and runs locally whenever possible. On the other hand, they're still going to alienate a chunk of their users. And since, by the way, there was misinformation being spread on this topic, I would like to stress that Mozilla is in no way collecting your data for anything related to AI training or selling to AI companies. So at least there's that. And of course, Mozilla also has a dedicated subsidiary for AI. All in all, with this article, I tried to give you a very brief overview and of different approaches and reactions to AI-generated content within the free and open source world. As you can see, some projects are actively endorsing this change, some are being more cautious, and some are just rejecting it outright. So let me know in the comments which ideas you have on this topic. And I'll actually read them. I do read all the comments, so I'll read them, but sure, go ahead and write them. That was everything, and links are in the video description if you want to help me out to do videos. And if you hate my pronunciation, there's the website with the articles as text. See you tomorrow.